Still met it early. Sort of. All right. So today is a very special day. And I better turn down the volume, it's a little high. So today is a very special day in the Vaishnav calendar, or on the Vaishnav calendar. It's the appearance day of Sita Devi. The appearance day of Janava Mata, and it's the disappearance day of a great Vaishnava named Madhu Pandit, the bugs. Okay. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari Gopi Jana Malaba Kiri Varadhaudi Gopi dana balaba giri varadhari Yasoda nanana braja jana nanjana Sudanandana braja jana ranjana Yamuna tira bana chaguri Yamuna tira bana chaguri Jai Radho Madhumba Kunda Vihagati Jai Radho Madhumba Kunda Vihagati Gopi jana balaba giri varudhaude Gopi jana balaba giri varudhaude Yasoda nandana braja jana ranjana Yasoda nandana braja jana ranjana Yamuna tira Banachari. Yamuna Tera Banachari. Jayurad Humadhuva Kunjabihari. Jayurad Humadhuva Kunjabihati. Jai Om Vishnupad, Paramahansa Paravidagacharya, also Teta Sitashi Shimad, His Divine Grace Abhaya Chalanada Bhaktivedanta Goswami, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, ISKCON Founder Acharya, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Anantakoti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai, Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Kujai Premse Kaho Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sidvaita Gadadha Sivasati Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Kujai Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gopikapatna Sayam Kunda Radhakunda Gidi Govardhan Kujai Vrindavanam Kujai Maturidam Kujai Jagadatha Swami Kajai Yamanamai Kajai Srimati Glasi Devi Kajai Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda Kajai Gaur Premananda Hari Hari Bol. All glories the assembled devotees. All glories the assembled devotees. All glories the assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga Srila Prabhupada Kajai. Okay, so Om Gana Timiranda Shatnama Om Vishnu Padai Krishna Pasai Budle Srimata Bhaktivananta Swamini Namini Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pacharani Nibhishesha Shunyavadi Paschacha Deja Tarni. So Om Gana Timiranda Shah Gananjana Shalakaya Chakshur and Meditam Yena Tasmai Shigurve Namaha Shila Prabhupada Gijai. So today is the glorious day of Sita Devi's appearance and Janava Mata's appearance and the disappearance of Madhu Pandit, a great devotee of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is not actually mentioned in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, but I'll mention him very briefly. So primarily we're going to talk about Sita Devi's appearance, and we need to talk first of all, as I usually do, about the ontology of Sita Devi, who she is. Of course, we have the Lord, that's Krishna, Ram, who expands. Krishna expands in various ways. Advaita Chuta, Nadi, Ananta, Rupa, Madhyam, Purana, Purusham, Navayovanam, Cha. There's one God, and he expands a variety of ways. And also, Krishna has his Shakti, and the Adi Shakti is Srimati Radharani. That's another name of Srimati Radharani. And the absolute truth can best be understood. Whoops. Oh. What is buzzing? So the absolute truth can be best understood by understanding the absolute truth male aspect and female aspect, rather than just think of the male aspect of the absolute truth. Of course, Krishna's Purusha and Radharani is Prakriti, the energy of the Lord. And so just like Krishna expands in various expansions, Radharani expands, the Shakti Tattva expansions, and her expansions are Lakshmi and Sita and all the different consorts of the various expansions or avatars or incarnations. Actually, I don't like that word, incarnation. But let's say use the word avatar of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, or expansions of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Like you have Lakshmi and Nrsingha, and I'm sure there's Lakshmi Kurma, and Lakshmi Varaha, like that. So this is very, very important to understand that, because wherever the Lord appears, he appears with his internal potency. So Sita is the internal potency. And so when Lord Rama appeared millions of years ago in the Treta Yuga, He appeared for the purpose of Pritranaya Sadhanam Vinashaya Chadushkutam, as described in the Bhagavad Gita, to establish religious principles, annihilate the miscreants, and protect the devotees. And of course, we understand that that's the external or exoteric reason for his appearance. But the esoteric reason for the Lord's appearance is to enjoy different rasas. And also, when the Lord's Shakti appears, she also enjoys different rasas and different bhavas, exchanges and emotions and things like that, because that's what makes life enjoyable for the Lord and for his consort. So, before Lord Ram appeared, you have this devotee of Lord Ram, that's the whole story of Jaya and Vijay, who appeared, or devotees, who appeared as various demons, like Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, and then Ravana and Kumbhakarna in those particular pastimes. So they appeared as demons in order to give the Lord or allow the Lord to taste these various rasas. Of course, rasa means taste, so I'm sort of repeating myself when I say that. So anyway, so they appeared for that purpose, to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So let's talk about Ravan, who is one of my favorite personalities. He, before Sita Devi appeared, had attained great power by executing many, many austerities and became very proud of his power and very lusty in addition to that, and thought that he could actually fulfill all of his desires by forcing the objects of his lust to succumb to his lusty desires. And so he made a few mistakes in that regard. One mistake is that he raped Ramba, who incidentally, in spite of being an apsara, is actually married to Nalakuvara. You know the whole story. So he raped her, and the story is told in detail, unfortunately, in the Valmiki Ramayana. He raped her, and Nalakuvara, he got so angry that his wife had been attacked like that, he cursed Ravan that if you ever force yourself upon a woman again, then your head will split into many pieces, you'll die immediately. So Ravan understood, you know, I better be careful with women, or at least, you know, I can propose to them, but I can't force myself upon them. And then another time, Ravan attempted to display his so-called superiority to that of Lord Shiva. So he went to Mount Kailas, and he picked up Mount Kailas with his 20 arms. You know, he had 10 heads, and for each head, of course, you get two arms. That's the deal. So he picked up Mount Kailas, and Mount Kailas started to sort of like shift from one side to another, and on top of Mount Kailas, of course, is Lord Shiva and Parvati. And Lord Shiva immediately put down his big toe and crushed Ravana's 10 arms under Mount Kailas, 20 arms, sorry, under Mount Kailas. And Ravana had to pray to Lord Shiva, was given benedictions, but he was also cursed at that particular point by Parvati, that he would die because of a woman. So you see many, many connections like that. And then, after he had achieved his great power, and even he conquered, or so-called conquered, death personified, or Yamaraj, he was flying around in his pushpaka vimana, which he had attained from his half-brother Kuvera, and he saw this beautiful girl on top of a mountain. And this girl was named Vedavati, and she was performing all these austerities in order to get Narayan, Krishna, as her husband. So he sees her, and immediately, you know, he comes in for a landing. Pushpaka Vimana coming in for a landing. Runway 22 right. Anyway, so He comes in for a landing, and he says to her, my dear young girl, you know, who are you? And she explains that I'm performing austerities to have Lord Narayan as a husband. And he says, basically, you're coming with me. And he doesn't rape her, obviously. He grabs her hair. And what he does, I mean, I guess it's like some of the stories you hear about the men grabbing the woman's hair, a caveman or like that, and they drag the woman into a cave. That's why the women have long hair, so the men could drag them. So he grabs her hair, and she gets so upset that he has defiled her body just by touching her body, that she, by her mystic power, she makes her hand like a knife, and then she cuts her hair in the middle like that. And Ravana is left with this piece of hair, and she says, because I've been defiled by you, I'm going to leave my body, but I'm actually going to take birth in your kingdom and be the cause of your death. So she performs this mystic yoga process by which she self-immolates. In other words, she burns her own body and she leaves this world. Of course, this is all passed on because she's actually the Lord's consort. So she leaves this world, and then later on, Ravan is in his kingdom of Lanka, and he's by the lake or by the ocean, and he sees this lotus flower, and on this lotus flower is a little baby girl. And then he realizes, uh-oh, that's the one. But, you know, at least he's Vedic enough to know he shouldn't be killing little baby girls. So he has, the story goes, he has Vibhishan, his brother, who's actually pious, he has his Vibhishan throw this little baby girl into the ocean just to, you know, I guess drown her or something like that. But he didn't want to just like cut her head off, so he thought he was going to kill her like that. And he throws her in the ocean, and she's taken by Varuna, the ocean god, and given to Bhumi, the earth goddess. And Bhumi takes this little baby girl, puts her in a little box, nice wooden box, takes her under the earth all the way to the kingdom, all the way to the kingdom of King Janaka. And King Janaka is actually a very interesting personality. King Janaka is a descendant of King Nimi, whose story is told in the Srimad Bhagavatam. King Nimi, very interesting story. King Nimi actually had a little disagreement with his guru. His guru was Vashishta. So what happened is that King Nimi wanted to do some devotional service, some devotional sacrifice. Ooh, the curtain fell down from that thing over there. Anyway, that's right. You don't have to fix it now in the middle of class. It just looks really bad. So King Nimi wanted to do some devotional sacrifice, and he said to his guru, I'd like to do this devotional sacrifice. And his guru, Vashishtha Muni, said, excuse me, he said, you'll have to wait until I come back from the heavenly planets. Vashishtha Muni wanted to go to the heavenly planets because in the heavenly planets, they give bigger donations than they do in the earth planet. So King Nimi understood that. So Vashishtha Muni goes to the heavenly planets. In the meantime, King Nimi does his devotional sacrifice. Very nice. And the guru comes back. And he sees that his disciple had disobeyed his order, and he gets very angry with his disciple, and he curses his disciple to die. He says, you shall be nirdeha. Nirdeha means without a body, or die, basically. And King Nimi returns the favor. He says to his guru, you should also be nirdeha. So both of them die. Guru dies, disciple dies. Nice relationship. So King Nimi's body is preserved in the oil because the brahmanas are in the middle of the sacrifice. And Vishishta Muni later on appears through the semen of Mitra and Varuna. That's a whole other story. So the brahmins are doing the sacrifice. They end the sacrifice. King Nimi's body is in the oil. And the demigods come and they say to King Nimi, king of the brahmins, please ask for a benediction. And they say, we want King Nimi to come back to life. So King Nimi comes out of the oil and he says, I don't want to come back to life. I'm in a spiritual world. What the did you bring me back to this material world for? And then he goes back in the oil. And then the brahmanas are thinking, you know, what are we going to do for a king now? Because King Nimi didn't have any descendants. So they actually churned his body. Churning, of course, means some sort of genetic engineering where they clone or something like that. They took the genes. They churned his body, and out of the body, I mean, this is very similar to the story of Vena, when they churned his body and they got Prutu and Archie. So they churned King Nimi's body, and out of his body came Janaka the First. Not the same Janaka that's the father of Sita Devi, but the Janaka that's actually the ancestor of King Nimi, of Janaka that we know. So anyway, so this was Janaka the First, and after Janaka the First, there was Janaka the Second, Janaka the Third, Janaka the Fourth, and we come to the Janaka who is actually the father of Sita Devi. So what happened is that the kingdom of Janaka, which is Mithila, and called Mithila because Mithila comes from Maiti, which means the churn. And the word Janaka also means he who was born Janaka. Anyway, so he has a problem. Janaka has a problem. And the problem is that there's a drought in the kingdom. And in order to sort of counteract that drought, the king actually has to go out and plow the land. But not only plow the land, but the plow that he's, you know, so it's not that he goes on a tractor or anything like that, because they didn't have tractors in those days. He actually takes an ox, and there's a plow with a golden tip on it, which is called a sita. You understand? So he plows the land, and as he's plowing the land just to draw the attention of the demigods to end the drought, the plow just stops. And they're just wondering, you know, there's something in the, is it a stone or anything like that? Just like if you're plowing something, you want to get the shovel out and you want to see what it is. So they take their shovels out and to see what's stopping the plow. And what's stopping the plow is this little box. Okay, box. Take the box out of the ground, open it up, and lo and behold, there is a little baby girl in there. And that little baby girl is Sita Devi. And so he says, well, this is my daughter. So I should actually accept her as my daughter. And she's, you know, beautiful little baby girl. You can't say no. And so he raises her as his daughter. And as she's growing up, something very miraculous happens. There's this bow in his kingdom that was given to him by Parashuram. Parashuram, of course, is the warrior incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He's a Shaktivesh avatar. He's not Vishnu Tattva. Shaktivesh means he's been empowered by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So he gave this bow, which is actually Lord Shiva's bow, which was used against Triparasura. And this bow is very heavy. It actually takes something like 100 men just to roll it on the ground. You know, it takes a lot of men just to roll this bow on the ground. So this bow is right in the altar room. And Sita Devi, she's a little girl, I guess she's about 5-6 years old at this particular point. She's playing around with her balls, you know, like they're with her friends, like that. And then one of them gets stuck somewhere. And she thinks, how am I going to dislodge that ball up there? And so she thinks, you know, let me look for a stick. And she sees the bow there. And so she just, with her hand, she grabs the bow and just goes, okay, boop, boop, like it was nothing, like it was just a very, very light stick of bamboo or something like that. And in the meantime, all the soldiers are just watching, because there's always guards in the castle. And they're watching. Oh my God. It took 100 of us just to roll it on the ground. And now she's done that. And then Janaka understands, all right, this is indicative of how we should arrange for her marriage. Because the person who's going to marry her has to be able to pick up the bow and string the bow. So he takes like this. So what happens is that later on it comes time for her swayamvara. Swayamvara means basically the girl picks her own husband. It's not that she's becomes like the trophy wife. In other words, there's a competition. Whoever wins the competition wins the girl. It's not exactly like that. She has the choice. She can say, no, I don't want to marry the guy who won the competition. And like you see in the case of Draupadi, there was Karna, who was actually quite capable of achieving the goal of shooting the eye of the fish, looking down at a pool of water on the ground. And Draupadi said, no, he's actually a Shudra. I'm not going to marry a Shudra. But she could have said no even if he was a Brahmin. So anyway, so there's the Swayamvara, and it's decided whoever can pick up the bow, string the bow, can marry Sita Devi. Okay, so they call for various persons. And actually, in the Valmiki Ramayana, it's never mentioned that Ravan tried to pick up the bow. That's only in the Bollywood movie. So different persons come. They're not even able to pick up the bow, what to speak of stringing it. And so Janaka is thinking, I guess my daughter is going to be a renunciate because no one could do this. Meantime, you have Ram and Lakshman who are with Vishwamitra Muni, and they've defeated these Rakshasas who have been harassing Vishwamitra Muni's sacrifice. And they're on their way to Mithila to witness this Swayamvara. Of course, on the way to Mithila, Ram frees Ahalya from the curse that she had because she had had a relationship with Indra. It wasn't her fault, really, because Indra had taken the form of her husband, Gotama Rishi. And then Ram arrives in Mithila, and there's so many descriptions of Ram's arrival in Mithila and the Swamishra Muni's arrival in Mithila. But anyway, they arrive in Mithila, and Ram goes to the bow, and he picks up the bow, attempts to string it, and the bow breaks. Now, the Acharyas describe that the bow broke not because Ram broke it, because Ram would respect Lord Shiva. But the bow voluntarily broke itself because the bow did not want to be used against Lord Shiva's devotee, who was Ravan. So the bow's broken. Sita Devi comes out, and she gives Ram the garland, because that's how they do it. There's an exchange of garlands before the actual big fire sacrifice and marriage ceremony. And they have the marriage ceremony. Everybody's happy. And not only does Ram marry Sita, but all of his daughters, all the daughters of Janaka, well, Janaka and his brother, marry Ram, Lakshman, Bart and Shatrughna. And so everybody's married. It's a four-way marriage. It's ecstatic. And then right after the marriage, who comes into the arena but Parshuram. And Parshuram is really angry because he understands that the bow has been broken. He has the ability to travel anywhere he wants at the speed of the mind. He doesn't reside on the earth planet because he gave the earth to Kashyapa. And he's taken a vow not to kill any more Kshatriyas. But you know, at this point, he's getting ready to break his vow. So he comes and he says, who has broken this bow? Who has broken the bow of Lord Shiva? And then you have Lakshman, who sort of like talks back to him. And he says, anybody could have broken this bow. And Parashuram is getting ready to basically kill Lakshman at this particular point. And Ram intercedes and he says, look, I'll take care of them. I'm the one who broke the bow, Ram. And Parashuram says, I'm Ram. You know, Parashuram, Ram with the axe. And if you think you're so great that you can break the bow of Lord Shiva, you should take the bow of Lord Vishnu and see what you can do with it. And so he gets ready to give the bow of Lord Vishnu to Ram. And then he looks at Ram, and Ram already has the bow of Lord Vishnu in his hands. So Parashuram understands. And then he has this vision, you know, who Ram is. He actually sees Lord Vishnu right there when he looks at Ram. And he thinks, uh-oh, I've made a big mistake. And at the same time, Ram has actually drawn the bow and gotten ready to shoot an arrow. And so the thing about Ram is that he has one arrow, one wife, one word. It's a famous expression. In other words, when he draws the bow, the arrow has to go somewhere. And he's not going to kill Parashuram. That's not appropriate. So he says to Parashuram that I've drawn the bow. So what should I do? You know, where should I shoot? And Parashuram says, well, I have two things you can destroy, because Parashuram is the one who made the offense, so obviously he's the one who has to be shot in some way or other. One is my ability to travel at the speed of the mind, and the other one is all my pious activities I got from all my austerities. So we can destroy either one of the two, but you can't really destroy my ability to travel at the speed of the mind, because I've given the earth to Kashyapa, and I'm not allowed to stay here for more than a few seconds or a few moments. So you better destroy the results of all my pious activities, which is actually really good, because by chanting Hare Krishna, you destroy the results of all your pious activities by worshiping the Lord. Because by chanting Hare Krishna, all your good karma and bad karma get destroyed. So it's not that poor Parashuram had to suffer. And he didn't have any bad karma anyway. You know, he's the supreme, he's an incarnation, Shaktivesh incarnation of the Supreme Personality of God. So, you know, that's Parashuram. He's one of the Dasha Avatars. But this is a pastime. So then Parashuram disappears, and Sita and Ram proceed at that particular point to Ayodhya. Oh. There's a person who played Sarpanaka. Anyway, so we're going to get... as well as Mantara, right? No. Just Sarpanaka. Okay. So, yes. Trijata. Oh, you played Trijata? No. Wow. We should do that play sometime. So anyway, so let's say you get into the story. So then there's the exile of Ram. Ram is asked to go to the forest for 14 years and be an exile. And he's thinking, let me just go alone, because I'm the only one who's supposed to be in exile. But of course, Lakshman insists, and he gives in to Lakshman. And then Sita Devi is very saddened. Actually, these are some of the quotes here. She was angry that Ram would leave her behind and go to the forest alone. She said, my lord, I cannot stay for a moment in a place without you. In your absence, this Ayodhya will be a jungle to me. The forest wherein you stay will be my kingdom. My life runs under your shadow. It is not becoming of you to leave me behind. And so Ram at that particular point describes the rigors of forest life. I mean, it's not easy. Like nowadays, you go to the forest, you bring your camper, and you have your mobile phone, you have all the amenities, and you can do Facebook Live from there. But in those days, and I was describing this last night in the class, there were tigers and all sorts of wild animals and rakshasas in the forest. And Ram describes, it's not cozy. It's not like a royal garden. There's wild animals, evil demons, etc., that infest the forest. You have to live on roots and wild fruits. You know, even if I tell the devotees in ISKCON, they just have to live on boiled vegetables and raw vegetables, they'll say, forget it, I'll join another movement. You know, that's an austerity if I told that to any of you. He said, don't worry, you know, 14 years, I'll be back. And she wouldn't listen. She said, this is actually an attestation to her chastity. Whether it is jungle or town, it is my duty to be with you. I do not care for comforts here. I am not afraid of the difficulties we may encounter in the forest. You are such a lion of the man. Can't you protect me there? And she began to cry, and Ram had to agree. So, you know, you talk about a submissive wife. She actually was dedicated to Ram, but it's not that she was just like, do whatever he said at any time he said it. She actually would argue with Ram to serve Ram, which is actually very important. So anyway, so they go to the forest, they go to Chitrakoot first, then they go to Dandakaranya, and Sita Devi again starts to talk back to Ram. She's very worried, and she feels even compassionate towards the Rakshasas and wild animals there. There's this whole section of the Ramayana, she says, she calls Ram by a very respectable name. She says, Aryaputra. You know, like Arya means those who know the higher values of life, according to Srila Prabhupada. In other words, high class, a son of the high class people. Let me submit to you a few of my thoughts. Please do not think that I'm more learned than you. You have now forsaken all the royal paraphernalia and come to the forest. Now you have to live like an ascetic and should not carry weapons. She's telling Ram, even though his duty is to protect the sages, kill the Rakshasas, don't carry weapons. By your promise to the sages, the Rakshasas will become your enemies. I am worried about this. We cannot say what danger might hit us at any time. And also, is it just to kill wild animals and Rakshasas who have not harmed us in any way? Hatred without reason may result in danger. Please think it over. Ram listened to the Sita's words. Actually, there's more than right here that I have written. The Sita actually cited some historical incident where Indra wanted to make a sage fall down. So Indra, at this particular point, didn't send the apsaras to attract the sage. So Indra gave the sage a bow. It's like, you know, give someone a gun, and it changes their personality. It's really interesting. You can try that one day. I mean, I know when I was young, you know, we had these toy guns, and as soon as they put them in my hands, it was just like, bow, bow, bang, 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 you're dead. Right? So Sita's citing this incident, Indra gave this sage, who he was very worried about because he thought the sage wanted to attain the kingdom of heaven. So he gave the sage the bow and arrow, and the sage, after a while, started cruelly killing animals. And the sage fell down as a result of that. So really dangerous, you know, put things in people's hands, and it changes their personality. It's really an interesting phenomenon, unless one is really Krishna conscious. You know, you put money in people's hands, it changes their personality. You give them any sort of opulence, you give them a nice car, it changes their personality. Anyway, that's an inside joke. So Ram listened to Sita's words. He says, Devi, listen. It's interesting how he refers to Sita Devi. You know, either Priya or Devi. Goddess. You know, Devi means like a goddess. That's really, you know, it's really sweet how in the Vedic system, the husband and wife refer to each other. You know, Aryaputra, Devi. I mean, it's just a very sweet exchange instead of, hey, Joe. Hey, Susie. You know, there's no sweetness to it, isn't it? Even if you have a nice name. Hey, Padma. So, sorry. So he said, Devi, listen, we are Kshatriyas by birth, and no time is objectionable for us to punish the evildoers. Can the Rakshasas attack innocent sages and devour them? Punishing them and protecting the innocent is our dharma. Your thoughts deserve consideration. You have thought about the matter seriously. I will go about this very carefully. So in other words, he doesn't say, you're completely in Maya, Devi. He says, I'm going to take this into consideration. I'm going to be really careful about this. And Sita becomes relieved when she hears this. So they built a hermitage. Actually, they didn't. Lakshman built the hermitage in the Dandakaranya forest. And then one day, well, it's interesting. We don't have that very much time. So one day, there was this beautiful Rakshasini, Sarpanaka, who was floating in the air. And usually you see in these stories the Rakshasas or Rakshasinis come in touch with human beings because they smell the human being. It's like, what is that? Fee-fi-fo-fum. I smell the blood of an Englishman. You know, so she smells the blood and but then she looks down and then she sees Ram, and she falls in love with Ram immediately. Wow. She changes her form, because that's one of the benedictions she got from Lord Brahma, and she makes herself extremely beautiful. Whoops. We only have 4 more minutes? Oh my God. We're in trouble. She makes herself extremely beautiful, and she comes out, Ram, I like you. And there's a sport between the two brothers that occurs at this point. Ram says, you know, that my wife is here, it just wouldn't work out. But Lakshman is there, his wife, well, his wife's name is Urmila. So Lakshman is without his wife. I'm sure he would appreciate your association. And she goes, Lakshman. And he says, well, you know, you marry me, you're going to be the servant of Ram. And if you go back, I'm sure he'll soon forget that thin-waisted lady, because Sarpanaka, she has like a beer belly. So anyway, so she goes back, she says, Ram, and then ultimately she gets really upset, understanding that they're just playing with her. And she says, I'm going to devour. And then her claws come out, you know, Sarpanaka, her claws come out. And Ram says, Lakshman! And Lakshman has this sword that's been given by Agastya, and he lops off her nose and her ears, and there's another part of the body I won't mention that the Valmiki Ramayan states. And so she's really in trouble, and she's bleeding all over the place. She goes back to her brothers Karandusha, and she complains, you know. In Karandusha, they say, we're going to get even. And so they send 14 giants to attack Ram. Ram kills them all with one arrow. Then 14,000 Rakshasas are sent, and Ram uses his bewilderment arrow and makes the Rakshasas think that each of the other Rakshasas is Ram, and they're fighting each other and killing each other. And then Karandushan come, and he kills Karandushan. So Sarpanaka at that particular point is really upset. The reason that, I'm not even talking about Sita Devi. Anyway, I got into the whole Ramayana. Sorry about this. But I can't help it. We'll talk about Sita later on. But the reason that Sarpanaka is in Janmashtan is because Ravana had killed her husband. Her husband was actually the king of the netherworlds. And Ravana was conquering the netherworlds. Killed her husband, and she's so angry at Ravan. She actually wants Ravan to suffer because Ravan had killed her husband. So, and she's also lusty. It's not that she's just faithful to her husband and a nice widow. So eventually she goes to Ravan and she says, you know, I was trying to get this nice girl for you. I saw this beautiful Sita Devi, and she actually should belong to you. And, which is a lie. She wasn't thinking like that. So Ravan goes to Uncle Marich, who's previously had a really bad experience with Ram, twice experienced. Once he was sent into the ocean 80 miles away when he was trying to interfere with Vishwamitra Muni's sacrifice. Another time he took the form of an eight-legged man-eating beast and to attack Ram, and Ram just like scared him away with his arrows. So Mareech is actually a renunciate at this point. He's just chanting Om Namo Shivaya, Om Namo Shivaya. And Ravan convinces him, you better go with me and lure Ram away from Sita Devi so I can kidnap Sita Devi. Mareech tries to give him some good advice, and he doesn't take that advice because Ravan actually threatens Mareech. He says, if you don't do this, I'm going to kill you. So Mareech decides it's better to be killed by Ram than Ravan. And so Mareech takes the form of a golden deer. I'm trying to tell the story real quickly. And he lures Ram away. Doesn't actually lure him because Sita Devi is insistent. I must have that golden deer. And even if you can't capture him and I can't keep him as a pet, I want his hide, which is all right for Kshatriyas. You know, Kshatriyas actually would kill deer sometimes. Practice. So Ram goes after this golden deer, and Lakshman is there protecting Sita Devi, and Sita Devi says to Lakshman, after Ram kills the golden deer, discovers it's Mareech, and Mareech is crying out in Ram's voice, Lakshman, Lakshman, Sita, help! Sita says, you better go help your brother. And Lakshman says, my brother's never going to be in any trouble. Don't worry, this is a trick of a Rakshasa. Actually, Lakshman knew all along that this golden deer was a Rakshasa. And Ram knew also, but this is a pastime because he had already arranged that Sita would be exchanged for Maya Sita, who was kept by Agni, the fire god. So it wasn't the actual Sita that was kidnapped. So anyway. You got me started with the Ramayana, and I just ignored my notes. Madhu Pandit, I'll just mention very briefly, he's not mentioned in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, but he's mentioned in the Bhakti Ratnakara and other literatures as the one who installed Radha Gopinath. Just like when we had this nice song, Radha Gopinatha, Radha Gopinatha, Radha Madhu Pandit Pranadana, hey, you understand? So he's the one who installed Radha Gopinath, who is the Prayojana deity. That's interesting. And of course, Raghunath Das Goswami is the Prayojana avatar. So sorry we didn't have more time. Those of you who want to hear more about Sita Devi, tune in tonight. Janavamati, yeah, I never got to. Sorry about that. I mean, you get me started with the Ramayana and I just get wound up. So. Jai! Radha Gokananda ki jai!
Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Enam Kanvam Dhammara Vindanalaya Taksham Bharavatam Samasitam Sakale Sitam Nikayanti Tirandarandi Angarajimaya Sadhu Kala Vigrahasya Govinda
Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pusra Guru
Sita Ram Jaya Sita Ram 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 Raghuvati Raghava Raja Ram Patita Pavana Sita Ram Raghuvati Raghava Raja Ram Patita Pavana Sita Ram Shri Ram Jaya Ram Jaya Dayo 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 Ram Hanuman, 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 Hanuman. Hanuman, 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 Hanuman. Raghuvati Raghava Raja Ram Patita Pavana Sita Ram Raghuvati Raghava Raja Ram Patita Pavana Sita Ram Shri Ram Jaya Ram Jaya Dayo 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 Ram Sita Ram, Sita Ram, Sita Ram, Jaya, Sita Ram. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hey, Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hey, Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Sita Ram Jaya, Sita Ram, Sita Ram Jaya, Sita Ram. Raghupati Raghava Raja Ram Patita Pavana Sita Ram Shri Ram Jaya Ram Jaya Jaya Ram Shri Ram Jaya Ram Jaya Ram Jaya Radha Golokinanda Radha Golokinanda Radha Hare Jaya Radha Golokinanda Radha Golokinanda Radha Hare Jaya Radha Radhe 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 Jaya Sri Radhe, Jai Om Vishnu Pad Padamahansa Paravidakacharya Also Tera Sitashi Shimad. His Divine Grace Abhaya Chalanana Bhaktivananda Goswami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai.
ISKCON, founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Anantakoti Vaishnavrinda ki jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur ki jai. Prem se kaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya. Prabhu Nityananda Sidvaita Gadadha. Shiva Siddhigaur Bhaktivinda ki jai. Shri Shri Radhakrishna Gopikabhata Shayam Kunda Radhakunda. Giri Govardhan ki jai. Vrindavanam ki jai. Maturanam ki jai. Jagadatha Swami ki jai. Yamunamai ki jai. Srimati Lasi Devi ki jai. Samaveda Bhakta. Vrinda ki jai. Gaur Premananda. Hari Hari Bol. All glories the assembled devotees. All glories the assembled devotees. All glories the assembled devotees. All glories to Shri Guru and Gauranga Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Vishvadai Krishna stai buddhulai Srimadabhakti Bhakti 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 Bhakti